Hello, everyone, and welcome to a very special episode of Ask Jochen. For those of you who have not tuned in to our show before, we do a few of these a month, and this is a very special episode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a very special episode of Ask Jochen.
Feedback there. Sorry, I just had to cut that out. So this month, or this today, we have a very special episode, a guest lecture, actually, with Marcia Kulak, who we will introduce into the session in a little bit. We're just going to play our intro session and then welcome Jochen into today's meeting. Welcome, Jochen.
Hello, Mary Claire. How are you?
I'm great. How are you? I'm very excited for today's meeting.
Yeah, super stoked. And I can't wait to do this. And I'm so excited that Marcia's here. I absolutely adore Marcia for many reasons. But why don't you go ahead and read a little bit of her bio so everybody can
know
this if they know not already.
Will do. Can we just go back really quickly to that page before? Perfect. So Marcia Kulak is joining us today. She is a top 3-day event rider and an international rider of over 25 years. She has successfully competed on some of the world's biggest stages and has been shortlisted for 2 Olympic Games. She has an extensive background in education with top international trainers and is best known for her classical and empathetic riding style, as well as meticulous care management and presentation of her horses. We are thrilled to welcome her to the show today. So welcome, Marcia. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you all for having me. This is a real pleasure for me. And Schleese and Jochen have been an incredible part of my journey, and I'm grateful to share some of that with you today.
Well, I'm psyched to get at least to hear you. I don't see you today, but sometimes maybe we can do it with video. I always look forward to see you at your place. As Mary Claire just read, your meticulous care of the horses and the barn and the people is just stunning. And being a fellow event riders, of course, I have a soft spot for you. So thank you so much for being on the webinar. I always like to surround myself with people who care about the horse. And if it's with veterinarians or special people such as yourself, I do get to hear that sometimes out of frustration, if it's a clinician or the veterinarian, they're kind of a struggle with the horses. And this typical saying, what I hear from clinicians, is 95% of the riders hang in the horse's mouth. The hands is the secret of riding. They bounce around the saddle. And we as event rider know we can't afford that. You know, so we have to be an absolutely quiet and meticulous rider. One of the neat thing what you do is you also specialize in horsemanship and in the hunter jumper world. You're very well known. So I'm really psyched that you're here. And of course, I have many questions for you. So the first questions I have, why don't you tell us a little bit, what was your history with saddle fit, and where were you before you found us, me, and how does the saddle fitting impact journey affected you?
Well, that's a great question, because over the years, early in my career of success as a young rider and entering the international stage, I had a number of sponsorship offers, which included tack and equipment. And so I explored saddles. And I have to say, while I recognized that the fit of the saddle was vital, a lot of people stress the comfort of the rider. So I think I also fell into that trap initially. Well, the saddle is fit on a specific type of tree. You know, they would say, well, it's a narrow, a medium, or a wide. and then you sit in it and decide whether or not you like it, and you go from there. So pretty early on, I realized that, well, many of these saddles were comfortable for me. If I rode 7 or 8 or 9 different horses a day, it was impossible for those saddles to actually fit a multitude of horses properly. And I became increasingly frustrated with that, because when we involve veterinarians and chiropractors and we spend so much time on the care of the horses, their shoeing, their nutrition, the way you ride, and yet one of the most integral parts of being able to communicate while you're riding is through your tack. So your bridle and your saddle play such a role. So I found for about a 10-year period in my career before, prior to that, I just didn't know enough. And then there was about a 10-year period where I was increasingly frustrated because I had 3 specific sponsorships, none of which I felt were particularly effective. And, you know, top chiropractors, as I got better and more educated and spent my winters in Wellington, I was exposed and surrounded myself with people who were better than me. And many held the same frustration. My horses' backs were sore. The base of their neck was sore. Why is that? And it all came down really to saddle fit. So fast forward to 2007, and I met fellow Schleese ambassadors, Tina and Jamie Irwin, who happened to rent a barn just down the street from me. And we were hacking around the block one day, and Jamie said to me, you know, your dressage saddle is too long on your mare's back. And I thought, well, explain that to me, because I just didn't have a concept for long or short. And so he did. And he said, well, I just have this guy I'd like you to meet. I said, okay. So he said he happens to be coming to Wellington to work on our horses next week. And that was Jochen. And so I thought, well, this is a good opportunity for me to educate and expose myself to potentially something very unique, which is basically what Jamie says. It was a saddle that was built on an adjustable tree that could be custom fitted to your horses. And that really piqued my interest. So I met you, Jochen, and you came in the barn and went through the horses. And I think what took me by such incredible surprise was your knowledge of anatomy and physiology and how saddle fit affected a horse's ability to perform or not. And literally no other saddle fitter had ever presented it with that amount of knowledge and education about the horse's shoulders and withers and rib spaces and why a saddle was too long. I just realized that I had opened a door of education that I was lacking. And there was a lot of, to me, research and innovation into the technology that you were putting to use. So it just turned out that I landed in what I thought was a gold mine, because somebody was in a position to educate me, to help educate my clients as to how we could get a top performance out of our horses. So that was kind of the Reader's Digest version of the beginning of this relationship, which is now 15 plus years old.
Wow. Thank you so much. I forgot about Jamie. So yes,
well, he was one.
That's the one how we got to know each other. And now that you're saying that, I kind of remember that, you know, how you were right beside him, and I got to see you and come to your barn, and the minute I stepped you into your place, I saw, wow, here's somebody who really cares and looks at the detail. And when I say looks at the detail, because this is what I always did, you know, for example, I'm looking at the small muscles. Oh, look at the big muscles, you know. So when I look at the saddle fit to horses, and veterinarians say to me, you know, a lot of small little muscle make up the structure, what makes it strong. And if a saddle sits on this spine, and I always said, no saddle sits on the spine. And I looked at the spinal versus processes, and it's as thick as a thumb. but these narrow little muscles. I have a slide up here which shows multifidus. It's a small muscle what gives the spine the strength. And if we put any pressure on it, we will put severely damage to the horse. And when I say severely, it doesn't show immediately like in a massive lameness, but it shows up, unfortunately, in a behavior issue, what I sometimes ignore. Oh, you know, he's just mad. You know, so there's an old saying, look at the horse's eyes, ears, mouth, they don't lie. So back to the fellow professionals, just like you, Marcia, when I surrounded myself with professionals and they says, you know, okay, these pictures I have up here, they're pretty harsh. But if a horse tries to get to the fence, jumper, hunter, eventer, or even just a pleasure horse, and tries out of the blue, bolts away, I need to ask myself, am I really that bad of a saddle, a rider? Or is there something that goes on with my saddle? If I'm an international show jumper and I keep falling to the right, so many horses go to the right. And I always love to say, the people who know the how will always follow the people who know the why. This is why I like to look what the experts are. When I talk about expert, I talk about veterinarians who research independent from sponsorship, from self-interest, how saddles sit and affect the horse. And every time I read a little bit more, I says, oh my God, do we ever deviate from the way our ancestor did it? And if we don't pay attention to the small detail, to the small muscle, like you, Marcia, when I walked in the barn, the attention to the detail you spent is fantastic. And I see you teach. This is how you teach. And I see your students to be successful and how you continuously be successful. And when I read from the research, something goes backwards, that modern English saddles damage our horses' back. I, as a master saddler, also fit saddles, feel kind of like attack. But these people who write this, they don't attack saddlers or want to make saddle people bad. They just say, these are facts. This is data. Full stop.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that's kind of where I lean towards it. And then I want to speak to people who says, okay, look at me. Look at my barn. I pay attention to the detail. And this is exactly what I want too. And this is, I think, why you and I connected so well. And we, after all this year, appreciate each other's knowledge.
Yes. And I think for me, you know, horses are so incredibly generous and kind. And many, many horses go in spite of us, not because of us. And as a rider and a trainer, I thought, how can I get every bit out of a horse? You know, eventing at the highest level demands everything from a horse and a rider, as an athlete and a pair and a partnership. It demands everything. And we pay so much attention to many things, but I quickly realized in my meetings and time spent with you that we didn't know enough about saddle fit, and that the other thing is horses change dramatically. I know that if I was preparing a horse, let's say, to go to Kentucky in April, that horse in December or January looks nothing like the horse I have in April. Event horses in particular change dramatically from their slow work early on, leading up to and including a big competition. They have a different body going in. And so I had never had a saddle that in that journey of 4 or 5 months, I could actually adjust to the horse's ever-changing physique. And it was something that frustrated me. And, you know, we use pads. You open up a catalog, you know, from a text or shop, and good Lord, how do you know how to choose a pad that's appropriate for your saddle? And you would explain to me, well, if the saddle fits well or doesn't, and you just get a pad of some description and you put it on, it's a little bit like taking your dress shoe and putting a big old athletic sock on it and sticking your foot in there. It really isn't improving the fit or the comfort. So I began to realize that my sport and my discipline at that time, trying to produce top level event horses, but then even having an adult amateur hunter, horses change and they evolve with age, with maturity, with work, with the time of year, the amount of work, the amount of travel. So why is it that we don't have saddles that can accommodate those changes? Or if you own a 5 or 6 year old, when that horse develops into a 8 or a 9 year old, he's going to be very different. Hopefully, if you've done your homework right and you're doing all your training correctly, that horse should be evolving. And a saddle that fits him at 5 or 6 may not be appropriate in a year or year and a half time. So I think that was my inherent frustration. And that was a problem that you readily solved just by virtue of the technology that's in your saddles.
Yeah.
And I'd never heard of a saddle that was designed for a man or a woman. You know, it was just you sat in a generic tree that is most likely going to fit it. Education, most likely going to fit a guy, not necessarily a girl. So there were a lot of things that you put on my plate that I was like, well, you know, this is an incredible way to help a horse develop to be its best and allow a rider to ride comfortably and in balance. And over time, you've accommodated all the different disciplines, which, as you know, a saddle that an event rider would ride cross country in is probably not the same saddle that you're going to ride a hunter in, and certainly a dressage horse or a person who trail rides and pleasure rides and shows occasionally might want more of an all-purpose saddle that they could accommodate their specific needs. So what you offered up, Jochen, were the opportunity to up my game, which ultimately, if we do better by the horses, then we're going to be more successful. And yeah, that's the bottom line under which I function, is these horses are generous and kind. And I said earlier, they put up with so much and many times they go in spite of us, not because of us. And I did not want to be one of those trainers that had horses that went in spite of me, not because I helped them become their best.
Yeah. I mean, you all know when a horse fights with you, it's such a better ride than a horse fights against you. You know, when the horse wants to do well for you and wants to approach a fence. And I mean, we all have horses who are proud themselves. Oh, but I just got mom. Look, but I just achieved mom. And you can feel it, how proud and happy they are. One of my questions I had for you, Marcia, is what are your priorities in saddle fitting? What do you look for in a saddle? I mean, you addressed it already a little bit about the adjustability, but what else is for you important?
Well, I think I've recognized that rider comfort is obviously very, very important, and a rider's ability to be balanced over the horse is critical. And so the thing that you offer is to fit a saddle to the rider's conformation. You're not necessarily purchasing just a saddle that has been made from a stock copy. So, you know, I look at the clients in my barn, I look at my own self, and I have riders, every one of us are shaped differently. Some of us have a long thigh, others are very short. And I have another gal who has a long leg and also a very long torso. And so the saddles, we've spoken a lot about how they accommodate the horses, but I also discovered that everybody is different. And therefore, really, a saddle that has so many options to fit a rider better so they can ride in a balanced feel. And I think if you deal particularly with juniors and adult amateurs who may have confidence issues and be a little out of balance on a horse, and when that happens, they get worried. If the saddle is fitted well and the rider is not fighting the saddle, then subconsciously they're in a position to ride to their very best because they're not really having to worry about staying in the middle of the horse. the saddle is helping to keep them in the right place because it's designed for their body type. And very few other saddle companies, I think, approach it that way. So what does make Schleese unique is, yes, we take the horse as a component of the equation, but we also have to recognize that the rider is an equally valuable component, and having a saddle that they sit in comfortably and well can make all the difference in the world for them to be, one, safe, two, successful, and fulfill whatever their goals are, whether it's a trail rider or a competitive rider. They still need to be in balance and comfortable, and you have provided that.
You know, you can imagine how I must have felt when I started making saddle, and my wife kept saying, "It's uncomfortable." And I was sitting in it. I asked my friends, my fellow saddle makers, "What's wrong with my wife? Why is she constantly complaining about my saddles?" And they said, "I don't know what's wrong with my wife, but that saddle is comfortable." And as we all know, you know, if you look back, majority of the saddles are made and were for male. And today, go in the tack shop, try to find male riding breeches. The whole industry has swapped from mainly male dominate to almost female dominate. That doesn't mean that they're still male riders. All I'm saying is, since the book came out from a medical doctor called The Rider's Pain-Free Back, which is written not from a sales or fitting saddles, just by simple, there is a different birth channel between a male and a female. Male doesn't have a birth channel, full stop. We have longer tailbones, different femurs, different lower backs, different structure, never mind about the muscles or other soft tissues. Then I start to think, maybe my wife, or I remember many of my students had this advantage because they were always fighting to sit over the leg. So once I started looking at this as well and went to Vienna, and I see they still have riders on the launch line for years to get the proper seat before they even learn how to go any further or touch the reins. And I think that's part what you also, what I see, how important it is for you that your students have a good seat. So my whole purpose in life is to protect horse and riders from long-term damage caused by saddle fitting. But like you already mentioned, there's so many other things we need to think about it, you know, from food to care to shoeing to training. All this plays a big role. And you mentioned already a lot of things what Schleese is different, but what would you say with having other companies sponsor you, is the one thing what really sticks out, what is the number one difference between the Schleese saddles versus other saddles you have been riding before?
Well, the number one difference is that the saddle can evolve with a horse. So if you have a horse that's ever changing, as I touched on, you know, my event horses in December are not the same horse before I go to Kentucky in April. And I never, you were resorting to a breastplate and to different pads and shims or any number of gadgets, ultimately, to try and have the horse, first have the saddle stay in place as the horses got tighter and fitter. And then I found that the horses were getting sore. And basically, I think it was a result of these narrow treed saddles that sat on the spine, sat on the multifidus muscle, as you mentioned earlier. And obviously, workload increases. I mean, it becomes increasingly important as you go up the ladder of stress and training and competition that your equipment be 100% appropriate. And I knew my saddles were not. So, you know, I think basically you had me at hello when I knew that this saddle could ultimately be modified along the road of conditioning as no saddle that I had ever been exposed to could. So between the using the the stuffing that you do and adjusting that in the panels and having a wider tree and then actually being able to adjust the tree, which, as we know, so many horses are one-sided. One side's a little overdeveloped, the other's a little underdeveloped. And being able to accommodate those differences, it made all the difference in the world. So I guess if I had to just say, narrow it down, the saddles fit me well. I was comfortable in them. I rode well in them. But I also knew that as my horses evolved, I could accommodate their evolution in physique through having a saddle fitting, you know, and knowing that I went into these bigger competitions with a saddle that wasn't inhibiting the horse's ability to perform at their very best.
So the thing what you keep mentioning, what's important to you, and I have to underline this again, it's the adjustability. And the industry, besides our saddles, has listened, right? They make saddles narrow, medium, wide. But I just threw a slide up where you see two different measuring devices, how you can measure the angle of the saddle. Marcia, are you able to see the slides, or are you in the area where you can't see the slides?
No, I can't see the slide, but I'm familiar with the slide.
Yes. So for the viewers who are looking at, you see here a digital angle finder, and with a gauge, the picture on the right shows the wither gauge. It's a tool that's over 115 years old. Just like cell phones, tools have become a little bit more sophisticated. And the good part is we can now show customers what the difference between a tree angle and a tree width is. And you mentioned it so lovely with saying the horse I have in January is different than the horse I'm taking to the competition partly through the year. Horses have no collarbone, and these muscles change us faster than body fat. Same with us. If we stop working out, we see it immediately. But good luck trying to lose weight if you are in that position. Where I'm going with that is I noticed, especially through COVID, that sometimes customer gets frustrated because the horse has changed and we can't get there. And we wanted to come up with something what we call a virtual fit, where people can literally take their phone and talk to us via FaceTime, or there's other ways to talk to us where the customer shows us the pictures and we can help them temporarily with the pads, like you said, Marcia. What pad do I use? You know, this slide I have up here, I call it the landmine picture. There is 14 points on the horse, what creates a negative reaction none of us riders want. I don't care if you are a beginner rider or an Olympian. No horse owner wants to have the horse bark or have all of a sudden increased risk of ulcer or colic or have permanent spinal damage. So if I don't want to step on a landmine, I need to know where these landmines are. And I wanted to take it even a step further. I wanted to say, okay, industry increases. We have now ways of measuring, because I started the topic of clinicians who complain how many people ride too much with their hands versus with their seats. Okay. We wanted to come and look what has the industry provided. They have provided rein tension devices. When I heard that first time, I said, what is a rein tension device? So there's actually a caliper between the bit and the attachment of the rein where they can see how much the rider pulls on their face. And wow. Then we go, and then we have now apps for free. Everybody can download it and they can take a picture of the horse's back, approximately 3 feet above the horse, and they can get a three-dimensional picture of the horse's back, which they can send worldwide, and we have the 3D image of the horse. Technology is really fascinating for me, and that's why I wanted to find people who appreciate it and look to for people. Here's that picture with the rein tension device that I was just talking about. It just reads out how much the rider pulls. And then, of course, we have computerized saddle pads, or what one of my favorite tools is the Fitbit for horses. It's a girth, what is attached. It's a sleeve, what goes over the girth, and what measures the horse's heart rate, calorie burn, left, right gait analysis, cadence, the how high he jumps over the horse, how symmetry is. And if you are a Marcia Kulak and is so successful over all the years, you can feel it. But as a saddle company, I wanted to understand what the top athlete like Marcia and of course the horse are really saying. So with that, we stopped with the traditional old-fashioned saddle making and went to the PSI panel. The PSI panel is a pounds per square inch. And Marcia, you have a light flight saddle. What has the PSI system in? Can you tell us a little bit what you experienced when you started to ride with the light flight saddle? What has the PSI system?
Well, I think that the thing that the PSI system has also brought to the table was, while it helped absorb or distribute the pressure across the horse's back to a level that was tolerable, you know, and caused less damage, it also helped the stuffing stay in better condition. So, you know, sometimes a client would say, for instance, wow, you know, we had this saddle fitted and now that, you know, we're challenged a little bit with the fit. And I would always say, you know, the horses change, they're a little on level, you sit a little to the right. So these things have to be addressed. And what the PSI panel did is I think it added a distribution of pressure along the horse's back, particularly over the area where the rider sits, but also for jumping horses right over the shoulder area where you have shoulder relief and with the PSI panel pressure relief. And so you can actually feel these horses have a greater willingness to articulate or bascule over the jump. By that, I mean they're more willing to really articulate the sling of the shoulder and lower their neck and bring their body up higher. And horses, I think when they land and they impact up into the saddle tree, can be very uncomfortable. There's tremendous force when a horse lands off of a jump. And remember, a horse lands on one front leg initially when it hits the ground. So that limb and all the way up through the back are taking a tremendous amount of vertical force. And what the PSI panel has done is it's minimized the pressure and the forces of the actual action of a horse's movement. And then you compound that with jumping, a wide jump, a tall jump, a drop into water, you know, ground variances where the horse's body has to absorb that concussion. If they jam up into a saddle with a very fixed tree, there's no opportunity to minimize the forces, whereas with the PSI plate and a properly fitted saddle, you're distributing that concussion and impact in a better way for the horse to stay comfortable under those conditions.
Yeah, so you can feel this, right, when you ride the horse and how he comes back after it, especially in your combination or more difficult task in the three-day eventing when you move up. What is so exciting for us, we have a lot of adult amateur riders who start and they are super smart. There might be engineers, there might be doctors, there might be one high power executive, but you know yourself, one of the oldest saying is you're only learning to ride when you ride. So more horses you ride, so more horses you feel. My old riding master always talk to me and says, it takes 3 human lifetimes to learn how to ride. So, oh my God, how frustrating is that? So I can see how frustrating it can be sometimes for people, especially when they're super smart, to say, how come I don't feel what Marcia feels? Well, because they don't spend so many hours on the horse. They haven't seen too many character of the horse. And this is where I come back to the PSI panel. Having technology like the Sieber girth, what is like a Fitbit for horses, what can measure the average jump height, having computerized saddle pad that can measure the impact of the saddle. There is no more sugarcoating. There is no more fancy talk in the sense of, oh, so-and-so rides in the saddle, you should buy it. It's data. It's plain and simple data. If the vital signs of a horse can be measured, which it can, and on one saddle, the horse's vital signs are up, increased heart rate, short stride, and in the other saddle with the PSI panel, lower heart rate, bigger increase in higher strides, softer landing, the way you said it. You know, that's what fascinated me on this. But on the other hand, it also frustrates me because we know that through the changes what a horse goes through, and there's 8 reasons the horse change: the shoeing, the condition, the training, the age, right? We are sometimes not fast enough when the change needs to be there. And while you, Marcia, you understand and you explain it to customers, on the other hand, you don't want to have the saddle adjusted so much, right? Like you just already said.
Correct.
Right, and I remember how clients said to me, you said to me, oh, yeah, we got to do something here. We can't keep doing the same thing over and over. The customer thinks this is never ending.
Correct, you know? Yes.
So with the PSI saddle panel, it not only holds the padding, it also eliminates the impact once the saddle is not 100% fitted. So what I said with the weight-bearing surface and the computerized saddle pads and all the testing, I also noticed that through, especially in the jumping, it's too bad you haven't a chance to look at the slides, but I have a slide right now here where there is a traditional stirrup bar. The traditional stirrup bar is attached to the metal plate in the front. Every single saddle has that. Okay, and once you do the testing and you do your 2-point, it's always in the front over the withers. And you wonder, how can the horse really have a nice muscular over the jump? How can he really come clear in the shoulder when all the weight of the rider hangs on the stirrup leather on these stirrup bars? So we just patented a center balance stirrup bar, which shows tremendous changes. And when you decrease the pressure, here is our binding tree with the PSI panel underneath, right? So we took the leather off the seat foam, the wool, so people can get an idea. And binate means made or born with 2 equal parts. And we started first with the PSI panel and noticed we can make the tree now much lighter. Because if you compare our saddles to our other saddles, you know yourself, experience, Marcia, that they're a little heavier than other saddle, isn't it?
Yes.
Right. So it could be an advantage.
The light flight, I will say, is you know, quite light and comfortable.
Yeah. So that has this particular saddle tree in, that's a binding tree. And what we have changed since then, you can see here's the light flight tree with the stirrup bar. What we have changed since then, we looked at all kinds of data and we wanted to decrease the pressure in the front even more. So we changed to this stirrup bar. And then we wanted to decrease it even more. So I understand you are the way to another competition, aren't you?
Yes.
Where are you going, by the way?
I'm going to the Green Mountain Horse Show, GMHA Horse Association in South Woodstock, Vermont, which has been, oh my goodness, it's been around since the 30s. The 1930s.
Wow.
And it's a wonderful show facility that appeals to all disciplines. They have driving, combined driving, eventing, horse show, dressage, competitive trail riding. There's the Vermont 100 mile that is at this showgrounds. They host a number of adult rider and junior rider clinics at the facility. So it's had a lot of history with my family, with my mom being there as a youngster, and I was there as a youngster. And they host 3 horse trials, actually four horse trials a year, and we generally go to every one. And it's just a great facility, and it's fairly close, which is nice. And they have levels from, you know, beginner, novice, starter, right up through preliminary at this one, and then their summer one in August through the 3-star level. So it fits a lot of bills, and I enjoy going. And the fall event is usually beautiful because the colors have started to turn up there. And
yes,
any rate, it's on our calendar a lot. And so this weekend, that's
how many horses are you taking?
I am actually just coaching this week, but we'll have 6 horses there.
Wow, phenomenal, phenomenal. Marcia, I would love for you to share with our audience a little bit the first time you rode Kentucky. Do you remember?
Oh, that? Wow. Yes, I do. That would have been, I believe, 1985. I was a young rider at the time, and I came up through the young rider program. And when I was a teenager, the young rider coach for Area 1 in the Northeast was Tad Coffin, who was fresh off an Olympic gold medal at the Montreal Olympic Games. And I had the privilege of being coached by him for a couple of years, and that kind of stepped me up in my game. And I was able to actually lease a horse named Cobblestone, who was ridden by Nancy Bliss at the 1982 World Equestrian Games. And Nancy was, I think she had some health problems, but at any rate, this horse was owned by a lovely family, and I was able to lease it for a year. And so my goal was to take Cobblestone to Kentucky. And it was an incredible experience because I was sitting on a horse as a young rider. I think I was 24 years old at the time, who had already been there and done that. And obviously that's a wonderful way for a rider to get introduced to the top level. And I felt well prepared. And of course I was brimming with confidence on a horse like this. So it was an amazing experience. And I think what is also, you know, unique to the equestrian sports is that you men and women compete on an equal basis, but also the older and the younger also compete on an equal basis. So when you're riding there with your idols who had just gone to a world championships or an Olympic Games, or who were preparing to go to Seoul, South Korea, hopefully to the Olympic Games, you know, it's an amazing opportunity. So that was my first experience going, and one of many opportunities to go there on a variety of different horses. And I think Kentucky, like many events, evolve over the lifetime of the competition. So my tenure going there, you saw different course designers, you saw them use the land differently. We saw the evolution of the dressage test, which was originally really a very simple, what I would call a lower third level test, to where now we're basically close to riding pre-St. George. And so the sport has evolved a lot, as you know, Jochen. The dressage level when you and I were very young was minimal. The expectation was minimal. And now, you know, you have to have a very good athlete that is equally competitive in all three phases to be competitive at the end of the day. Yeah. So we've seen the sport come a long way. And I realize, you know, obviously when you look back in hindsight at how much you didn't know, but you still got away with. And then you hopefully evolve as education and time, you become better horse people and you pay more attention to the details and you realize that the details are ultimately what bring you success. So the whole thing comes full circle from having a good athlete to start with and then knowing how to condition and train and maintain it. And that includes using good equipment and surrounding yourself with good physical therapists, with veterinarians, with farriers who all work together along with your coaches to produce a better product in the end, which is really what we're trying to do when we're competing. So, and I think it, you know, the sport allows you to learn how to deal with the ups and downs, you know, that horses inevitably bring at all levels, not just at the higher levels. People know that if you have horses for pleasure, they still sometimes have issues. And so I think that growing up as a youngster, horses teach you a lot of value. They teach you a lot about responsibility and relationships and sometimes tragedy and sometimes hopefully triumph. But it's a very character developing process, and a 3-day eventing probably a little bit more than some of the other disciplines. But I've been privileged to do this. And now I feel like the give back is very important, the give back in my coaching and in the horses and teaching people, educating them about what I've been fortunate enough to know. And hopefully, ultimately, if you educate people at a younger stage in their lives or even adult amateurs, perhaps you allow them to avoid some of the mistakes that you made in your career. And I think that that is incredibly important. And if you can begin to do that for young people and even adult amateurs who, you know, maybe rode as youngsters and then came back to riding. I think about you talking about saddle fit and having it fit the rider. I think adult amateurs want to be safe and comfortable. And if you can allow the horses to go better through good training, good care, and obviously proper equipment fit, then these adult amateurs get on and they have fun. And when they have fun, they want to do it more. So from a business aspect, it pays to do the best you can for them and for their horses, because ultimately that's a customer that's happy and that comes back and shares their experience with other people. And then suddenly the business grows. And so if you think about it, everything is connected. Everything that we do with our horses is connected, either in a good way or in a not so good way. So I think not leaving any stone unturned is an opportunity to enhance your business in many ways and gives you a sense of hopefully accomplishment and security in doing that.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned something absolutely vital and funny that from everybody I've spoken in the past, from Olympian to veterinarians to professors, you mentioned you're the only person that says this is the sport where men and women compete together and no age group. And let's don't forget one of our favorite people, you're on the mind, your mom. Didn't she do a century ride?
She did. She did a century ride on a wonderful off-the-track thoroughbred that developed into a lovely dressage and jumping horse. And, you know, her equipment made it possible for her at her age with, you know, adult amateurs, especially older people, they've got arthritis and they might have it in their knees or in their back or in their hips, and allowing them to be comfortable in the tack and, of course, have the horse go well underneath them, that extends the longevity of their career that they otherwise may not be able to enjoy. So, yeah, I mean, we're talking about all generations. It's really significant how we can impact them in a positive way, doing what we have been discussing in the course of this conversation.
Yes. And, you know, when you were saying when we were competing younger, you remember how many times we bounced off the horse and we bounced right back at it. And now that we're getting a little older, it's not so bouncy anymore, right? So it takes a little longer to lick your wounds. And this is the same with the horse, you know. And like you mentioned so beautiful, we want to look at the details. And one of the details is, you know, we talk about pressure on the withers a lot. We talk about I call them minefields, the reflex points, what causes a reaction on the horse. And just like us, when we get older, the horse, the same thing. They're getting more brittle and they're reacting faster. So if I have somebody special like your mom or any adult amateur rider who still rides in their 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, you know, those people, they don't want to sit on a firecracker. They don't want to sit on something unsafe because the horse reacts out of pain. So knowing, for me, as a manufacturer and saddle fitter, and as a rider, where these landmarks are, let's stay aware of it, full stop, period. And if I'm competing, and I know there's one particular spot on the horse's back what causes major problem to the respiratory health of my horse, which can be affected by the girth or by the saddle, why in the world would I not pay 100% onto this particular situation? And that's, I'm feeling the broken record, but this is what made you and me connect so well, because you are looking at the detail. And this is why I'm so pleased to have found you, or that we have found each other, and we can share through your teaching and through your knowledge, through your and to your fame, everybody who knows you, that we can do more for these horses. And with this webinar, many people will listen, we will tape this, we will share this. And of course, Mary Claire is here, and we always like to leave a couple minutes extra at the end of the hour for some question and answers. So Mary Claire, how are the question and answers coming in so far? Well, we will give the answers, but how about the questions?
I will just open up the floor right now, just to let everyone know who is currently watching on Facebook or YouTube. Feel free to let us know if you have any questions. I haven't received any so far, just some lovely comments from people watching who are relating to what you guys are saying throughout the episode. I will just open up the floor right now. If you guys would like to send us your questions, please just let us know. I do have one that was written ahead of time that was just, what major takeaways would you like viewers to walk away with from this discussion, Marcia? If you had one takeaway to leave riders with, or you know, any kind of equestrian with from this episode, what would you like them to walk away with?
Well, I think the thing that's most important really is education. Jochen just touched on the 14 points. And one of the things that I feel very privileged to have had the opportunity is to actually have that shown to me, have that explained to me. I never knew any of that until I met Jochen and had him draw a diagram on the side of the horse for me, and the wither pattern and the ribbing pattern and why a girth should fit proper, how a girth should fit properly. So when my clients were exposed to that, and that level of actually knowing what the horse is going to feel when a saddle is on, either fitting correctly or incorrectly, I think education and knowledge are power. And that's probably why I drank the Kool-Aid, because I really recognized that I didn't know enough. I didn't know enough about the anatomy of a horse and how saddle fit affected their ability to perform. Plain and simple. I just did not know until I experienced someone of Jochen's knowledge and, you know, his willingness to share and want to do better. The way things were in 2007 and the way they are in 2022 is very progressive, very different. And I admire that we're not standing still and resting on our laurels. We're actually designing and, you know, talking about what technology can provide us with. So for me, it's education. And when a new client comes to the barn, I want them to understand why I believe in this equipment and why I would like them to ride in a Schleese saddle. And once you educate someone who wants to be educated and wants to do right by their horse, most everybody is like, wow, I just had no idea. So I think, putting it in a very simple way, it comes down to education. And today with computers and websites and these incredible webinars, we have an opportunity to do something we've never had the chance to do. So I think any horse person who wants to delve into riding and having a horse, even if they don't want to compete, most of them want to do right by their horses. Their horses are a big investment. And if they do a little research and go online, Schleese provides an opportunity for education that is amazing. And it was Jochen's ability to educate me that put me in this position to believe in the Schleese equipment.
So what I hear is a major takeaway is that the education, so you understood the why and not just the how, what made you feel, okay, that makes sense, I can follow, and now I have a choice as a consumer to do something. Because most of the time, you say, I can't constantly buy a new saddle or constantly new pad, and my performance doesn't work out just because I keep buying new pads. So by keep coming back and giving the customer the education, that is what I think is very close to me, because as I said in the beginning, the person who knows the how will always follow the person who knows the why. So by empowering our client, and this is how we met. Jamie came right to you. You know, Jamie came to you and says, Marcia, your saddle is too long. And so many people buy so many good horses and cripple them unintentionally because the saddle sits in the lumbar area. And unfortunately, if I have shoes on which are too small for my long feet, eventually I deform my feet or I get blisters or I suffer my walk, my knee, my hip, my back hurts. And this is nothing different right with a saddle. Full stop. Mary Claire, any other questions?
I'm thrilled I had the opportunity, you know, to land in that position. It was just luck, basically.
Well, I think deep down, you and I, we always look for each other.
Yeah. And you know what, Jochen? I did take what Jamie said to heart. I had an open mind and I was like, well, then I'd like to meet this person, you know? Sure. So if you're in a position, that's the other thing, you know, you have to want to learn. You have to want to do better. If you're going to keep your head in the sand, then there's not a lot you or I can do about that. But when the opportunity presented itself, I walked through the door.
That's right. If you don't look for the answers, how can you find them? Right. Well, let me say, I know you're super busy and you're on your way to this wonderful horse show, and I can just imagine how beautiful it is. Please, please, please give a big hug and a kiss to your mom. And from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for being part of this. And hopefully we can do it again. I have so many more questions for you, but it's only an hour and I know you're very busy. So again, thank you so much for being on our webinar.
Thank you, Jochen. And you know, I will do it again in a moment's notice. So I'll look forward to the next time.
Thank you. Have a wonderful rest of your day.
Thank you. Bye, all.
Bye. I don't know.